Well, welcome to the 31st meeting of 2015 of the Rural Affairs, Climate Change and Environment Committee. Before we move to the first item on the agenda, can I remind members to switch off their mobile phones if they're going to make a sound that interferes with our concentration or the broadcast system. You may notice committee members using tablets during the meeting because the papers are provided for some in digital format. Agenda item one today is consideration of items in private. The first item on our agenda this morning is to decide whether to consider item five, the consideration of our work programme, in private. Are we agreed? Yes. The committee is agreed. Thank you. Agenda item two, subordinate legislation. And the committee is to consider the draft Environmental Regulations Enforcement Measures Scotland Order 2015. This instrument has been laid under affirmative procedure, which means Parliament must approve it before provisions may come into force. Following the evidence session, the committee will be invited to consider the motion to approve the instrument under Agenda Item 3. And I welcome the Minister and the Scottish Government officials to the meeting. Welcome Minister for Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform, Dr. Aileen McLeod, George Burgess, Deputy Director of Environmental Quality Division, and Bridget Marshall, Environmental Quality Division, Scottish Government. And Minister, would you like to make a short statement of introduction?
Thank you, and good morning, Convener, and my thanks to you and the rest of the committee for inviting me here this morning to discuss this important order, which is a key component of our wider Better Environment programme with SEPA. And Scotland's environment is a vital natural asset, and protecting it is not just a viable end in itself. It is also essential for our economic prosperity and the health and well-being of people in Scotland. Now, while everyone in this country has a part to play in helping to look after our environment, it is essential that bodies who have statutory obligations to protect and improve our environment, such as SEPA, have the powers they need to do that job effectively. The vast majority of individuals and businesses in Scotland already comply with relevant environmental regulations, and indeed a significant number go beyond compliance, recognising that waste reduction, resource efficiency and other good practice are not just beneficial for the environment but also make good business sense as well. But where individuals or businesses deliberately or negligently harm Scotland's environment, it is essential that SEPA has the right tools to protect our environment and communities and to ensure that legitimate businesses are not undercut by criminals. It is just simply unacceptable that anyone should profit by damaging our environment. Now, this order implements most aspects of Chapter 2 of Part 3 of the Regulated Reform Scotland Act 2014 by making provision for a range of new enforcement measures for SEPA. Now, these measures include fixed and variable monetary penalties, enforcement undertakings, non-compliance penalties and cost recovery notices. These enforcement measures will provide SEPA with a better range of interventions to tackle poor performance, non-compliance and environmental crime, and to help create a level playing field for businesses. They will also help SEPA to take a preventative approach, facilitating early engagement and intervention to prevent compliance issues from escalating and becoming prolonged, or through their deterrent effect, prevent such issues from happening in the first place. Now, SEPA are well aware of the significance of the additional powers and responsibilities that we propose to give them, and they are committed to ensuring that the measures are used responsibly. In addition to the safeguards in the order, such as the right of individuals to make written representations and to appeal against enforcement decisions, SEPA are also putting in place a wider range of safeguards to ensure that the new measures are used proportionately and effectively. This includes comprehensive training on the intent behind and use of the new measures for SEPA officers and the establishment of a robust internal review process that's designed to ensure appropriate and consistent use of the new measures within SEPA. SEPA have also recently completed a public consultation on their new enforcement policy and revised enforcement guidance. Now, these key documents provide transparency on the way in which SEPA will make enforcement decisions, and they set out not only what SEPA expects of regulated businesses, but also what regulated businesses can expect from SEPA. It is important to recognise that the new measures are part of a wider framework of environmental protection and that they will not be used in isolation. SEPA will continue to refer significant, persistent and deliberate offending to the Crown Office and Prosecutor Fiscal Service for considerations of prosecution, and close working between SEPA and the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service will be a key aspect to the successful operation of the new framework. And this partnership working between SEPA and the Crown Office and the Procurator Fiscal Service will be underpinned by guidelines from the Lord Advocate, which will be issued shortly. These guidelines will ensure that the new enforcement measures will be applied consistently and proportionately as part of the whole range of sanctions that are available, including prosecution. Just to conclude, convener, stakeholders have also played a vital role in helping to develop these new enforcement measures, and I would like to take this opportunity to thank all those who responded to the consultation or engaged through other means. The positive feedback received has been absolutely vital in shaping our proposals, and I encourage stakeholders to continue to engage as we deliver the rest of the Better Environmental Regulation Programme. So thank you very much, convener, for this morning, and I'm happy to answer any questions on the draft order.
Thank you very much, Minister. Yes, indeed we do, starting with Graham Day.
Convener, good morning, Minister. I have a couple of questions. The first one concerns restorative action. I'd like you to outline for us how that will be monitored in practice, and perhaps explain to us how you believe that SEPA have the physical resources to oversee the restorative action being undertaken. The second one concerns the appeals process. I never thought I'd see the day where, referencing the Land Court, we were talking about swift and affordable access to justice and a light-touch approach. So I'd welcome a clearer understanding of how that process will work. Thank you.
Okay, I think Bridget Marshall is going to pick up your first point, and I'm happy to take up back on your second point around the appeals process.
Sorry. In relation to restorative action, these measures, particularly the enforcement undertaking, are designed so that the focus as a result of the enforcement action is to restore the environment. So the whole purpose of these tools is to try and get the environment restored in perhaps a more formal manner than it currently is. So I think your question was around how SEPA will manage this and ensure that it is carried out. So the enforcement undertaking is probably the main vehicle for ensuring the restoration of the environment, as opposed to taking monies away in a fine, which goes off to the Scottish Consolidated Fund. If you fail to comply with your enforcement undertaking, then SEPA goes back almost to square one and can issue a fine or refer you to the fiscal. So it will be part of the process to ensure that the restoration of the environment occurs under an enforcement undertaking, and SEPA is structuring itself to be able to ensure that the enforcement takings are complied with.
So if I may, though, are we confident SEPA has the resources on the ground to ensure that the restorative action has been taken? Because somebody's going to have to check.
I think SEPA is developing a process whereby it will ensure that it has sufficient resources in place to monitor that the enforcement undertakings are complied with.
Does it have the staff to do?
That's the point.
That's the nub of the matter of enforcement.
Yeah.
It's a bit like councils having enough people to see that building regulations are carried out, sort of thing. Alec Ferguson.
Surely, if an offence has been determined in the first place, it must have been determined by presumably SEPA staff, and therefore it can be monitored thereafter.
We're just exploring this process, so that's George.
I mean, certainly, the initial stages of the process will be the same, whether a case is heading towards reporting to the Procurator Fiscal or heading towards one of the new enforcement measures. Reporting a case to the Procurator Fiscal, taking it through the court, is itself quite resource intensive. So what this provides is an alternative way to use the resource that SEPA has and that would otherwise be putting into a court procedure, but putting that instead into working on the ground, working with the businesses and concentrating on the restoration of the environment. So I think out of that, it's a redirection of resource that SEPA already has and redirecting it towards getting a better outcome for the environment rather than simply pursuing it through a court route.
In terms of the appeals process, I mean, certainly the order does provide for a robust appeals process, making use of the expertise and experience of the Scottish Land Court. Now, the use of the Scottish Land Court as the appeals mechanism, now that responds to stakeholder desire for an appeals route that was independent of Scottish ministers, and that would provide, you know, like immediate and affordable access to justice for appellants. Now, in discussion with the Scottish Land Court, we have taken the opportunity in the order to adjust the rules of the Scottish Land Court so that cases can be dealt with by written submission and to limit the circumstances in which expenses can be awarded. And we've also adjusted the fees order for the Scottish Land Court so that it is also free to apply for an appeal. And these amendments are really to ensure that the Scottish Land Court can provide, you know, an accessible, swift and a low-cost appeal system.
Okay. Sarah Boyack.
Thank you very much, Convener. I'm very interested in the principles behind this statutory instrument, and it makes a huge amount of sense to me. Can I ask about the particular issue of waste crime? Because there is a huge problem, not just in my own region, but I know across Scotland. Can you specify how this potential piece of new legislation will assist in getting swift action on really poor environmental quality and damaging waste crime problems that are, I think, a real scar in a lot of our communities?
I mean, I think certainly in general terms, you know, that, you know, SEPA is, you know, presently relying on, you know, quite a narrow range of enforcement tools and ultimately on referral for prosecution to tackle non-compliance and environmental harm around like waste crime. So we want to empower the agency to be able to take a direct but proportionate approach to protecting our environment and our communities. And I think the new powers that are created by the order, they will certainly play a key role in helping SEPA to be able to take a preventative approach. Now, the enforcement measures will help to deter non-compliance, you know, in the first place, and they will also enable SEPA to be able to intervene much earlier than what they've ever been able to do so before, which will prevent cases, I think, of non-compliance escalator or dragging on for months and years to come. So, George, you want to add?
I think just to add that, as the Minister said earlier, this is part of a much wider spectrum of measures. So for some of the serious waste crime that I know a number of members will have seen in their constituencies, it's probably not so much this order that provides the solution, but it's the other measures that we've already implemented in the Regulatory Reform Scotland Act 2014. So additional powers for the court to ensure that the financial benefit of offending is taken out through any penalty that is imposed, improved powers of entry, search and seizure for SEPA. So for the top end, where unfortunately is where a lot of our waste crime is, it's those other parts of the Act that will really help SEPA to deal with it. However, as the Minister says, at the lower end, where there are people that are in SEPA's enforcement or compliance spectrum, the chancers rather than the outright criminals, this is the way that SEPA will have a bit more hold on them to be able to guide them back onto the straight and narrow rather than see them head down towards the more criminal end of the spectrum.
Can I welcome that answer and ask the Minister if she will commit to make sure that there's a review and monitoring process? Because I think these are really problematic crimes. And it's a huge environmental justice problem. So I think it'd be really interesting to see how the combination of measures actually works in practice. And if we could get it split down by type of crime, I think that would make it more transparent for everybody as well and help make that preventative impact that I think you're trying to make.
With that, and I'm happy to do that.
Thank you.
Perhaps just to add to that, the Environmental Crime Task Force, which has been running for a couple of years, is still running. That's looking very much at waste crime. There's also an opportunity for the Parliament and this committee to be involved. Section 52 of the Act commits Scottish ministers to provide an annual report on the operation of Part 3 of the Act to the Parliament. So that includes these measures, it includes our new authorisation framework and the new court powers. So we will be providing an annual report to Parliament on that whole range of activity.
So that's fine. That would give our committee a chance to actually look at that. It's one to write down for our next year, indeed. Dave Thompson and Claudia Beamish.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister and colleagues. On the Scottish Land Court, are you confident that the Scottish Land Court does have the capacity to deal with these things? Because there have been issues in the past, I think, as my colleague Graham Day alluded to, that the Scottish Land Court can take a long time to deal with things.
Working very closely with the Scottish Land Court, and we have had many discussions with them, and they are confident that they have capacity to deal with these cases. We're not expecting a huge volume of appeals each year, and particularly in the first instance, we're phasing the measures in, so the volume of appeals is not expected to be that high, and they felt confident that they had sufficient resources within their current resources to deal with the cases. And as we've previously referred to, we have worked with them to try and adjust their procedure in this order so that they do try and create a forum which works effectively and is cost effective as well.
Okay, thank you. And just a couple of other points. The appeals process, it's good to see that the SLC can determine appeals without a formal hearing, but I think the notes go on to say where appropriate or where both parties agree. Is SEPA going to be encouraged to agree to these sort of things? Is this something that would be a presumption in favour of SEPA agreeing to go through, not going through a formal hearing?
I think where it's an appropriate case, and we have in mind particularly the fixed monetary penalties, say, of £300, where the legal issues should be, or the appeal issues should be relatively straightforward, that certainly it will be encouraged that these are dealt with on written submissions. There will clearly be some more complicated cases where it won't be appropriate to deal with them on written submissions.
I imagine an awful lot of the time the appellants, the businesses, are going to be very happy with a truncated process, but SEPA might think that it's not in their interest. So it's just to, get on the record that there would be a presumption that SEPA would, wherever possible, go for the shorter process without a formal hearing.
I think there's benefits for SEPA as well as businesses in following the truncated procedure in appropriate circumstances, and that presumption will be there.
Just finally, Convener, on expenses, it's good to see that expenses will not be awarded in relation to an appeal and except in relation to any court fees paid. That's fine, but an appellant may well, if it goes into a formal hearing situation, have to engage lawyers and others and could run up pretty substantial expenses with no way of getting that expense back. So is that not a discouragement to a business that has been accused by SEPA of a crime to actually engage in an appeal if their expenses could maybe run into many thousands of pounds?
Yes, we did consider this issue in quite a lot of detail, and there are arguments on both sides, but we thought on balance we were trying to create an appeal forum where we were not encouraging the engagement of expensive QCs or lawyers to defend your case where it wasn't perhaps necessary, and we felt that having removing the expenses rule, the usual expenses rule where expenses follow the event, would create an incentive to maybe represent yourself rather than employing lawyers, and that goes for SEPA as well as businesses.
It might be difficult for a business to represent itself. SEPA will have resource and so on, and it's fine that the business wouldn't be liable for the SEPA expenses, legal expenses and so on, but if it's a difficult case, then the business might need to employ counsel or so on, and it could be expensive, and that might discourage them from appealing a SEPA decision.
Yes, we accept that, and the balance to that is that for small businesses who may be, it may be a disincentive not to appeal if they feel that they may be exposed to the possibility of having to pay SEPA's expenses. So it was a balance.
SEPA's expenses, their own expenses, hiring their own QC.
Yeah, I think we were certainly of the view that for some appellants, particularly the small businesses and sole traders, that potentially being held liable for SEPA costs would disincentivise appealing, and you know, that's clearly undesirable. So our intention was not to discourage appeals, but to provide an appeal system that offers fair, swift, and cost-effective access to justice. And so I think the order therefore limits the expenses either way in cases where, to cases where a party has acted unreasonably in bringing or conducting proceedings. And we think that this approach, together with the removal of the requirement for appellants to pay a fee to lodge an appeal, we think that kind of strikes an appropriate balance between affordability and fairness.
I still don't think you've answered my question, because an appellant will still have to pay their own legal fees, and their own legal fees could be substantial.
Yes, an appellant will have to pay their own fees. There is the provision that if there has been a serious failure on the part, in this case, of SEPA, so if they have just got the whole thing completely wrong and the appeal is successful on that basis, in those cases, the court can award expenses against them. It's perhaps worth remembering that the alternative to this for the majority of the more serious cases would be pursuing a case through the criminal courts. And there, I think the expenses and what's at stake would be considerably higher than anything that's possible through this order.
Okay, thank you.
Claudia Beamish, Angus MacDonald, and then Mike Russell.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister, and good morning to you both. The main points that I wanted to highlight have actually been raised by other members, and so I'm not going to re-rehearse those, but I would endorse the comments that have been made, perhaps most importantly, because I do believe that revisiting this is very important in terms of committee legacy paper, and I hope that we might be able to discuss that in our work programme. Or the legacy paper later, but particularly in relation to such things as how the partnership working between SEPA and the Procurator Fiscal's office is going, in view of the fact that the idea is to resolve the environmental difficulties rather than get people into the courts, unless, as you've highlighted, George Burgess, other parts of the Act which relate to possible organised waste crime, for instance, would be dealt with in a different way. But I do think this is very important, having been on the committee at the time when the Act went, when it became an Act, the Regulatory Reform Bill, with a number of other members. And so I hope that this will be possible.
We are having the opportunity to produce the annual report, which then will go to the committee itself. Then that then gives an opportunity for the committee to be able to scrutinise that.
Thank you.
Angus MacDonald.
Thanks, Convener. My point on waste crime has already been covered by Sarah Boyack and Claudia Beamish. However, from a constituency perspective, I very much welcome the new order. The Minister and her officials, including George Burgess, will be aware of waste management issues in Falkirk District and elsewhere in the country, where even licensed operators have regularly breached environmental regulations, and there's been regular non-compliance issues with certain operators. So taking on board Mr. Burgess's earlier point that other parts of the Act are going to help, I think it's fair to say that SEPA officials have been exasperated, as I have, at times when dealing with some of the rogue operators, and certainly I hope SEPA will use these new monetary penalties to good and enforcement powers to good effect, and will not hesitate when action is required, because there's been cases in the past where there has been a perception that SEPA were reluctant to use the powers that they already had, and hopefully that will not be the case in the future.
Thank you. Mike Russell. Yes, politicians are never happier than when they're talking about penalties of one sort or another, which always makes me slightly nervous. And I was certainly concerned to hear Mr. Burgess use the words entry, search and seizure. I do really want a reassurance from the Minister that SEPA's success in being proportionate, in being persuasive, in trying to change the context of thinking about the environment in Scotland and about regulation will remain its primary focus. And the easier issues of simply applying fines, of saying to people, you're a malefactor and we're going to punish you, is not the default option. Because SEPA has changed a lot as an organisation in the last 10 years, and that change has been highly successful because it has been changing the climate of how environmental regulation has been undertaken and the climate of how we all regard the environment. So I'm just looking for a reassurance about that. I know this is out of context, in the sense that this is one item in the armoury, but I just hope it won't be overemphasised because it is easier to regulate in that way than to do it in the really effective way they've been doing it up until now.
No, and I agree, and I can give you my reassurance on that today.
Thank you.
Thank you. Alec Ferguson.
Well, thank you, Convener. I think my question follows on very neatly from Mr. Russell's question there. And I know and I fully accept that where my question's going is not the intention of the paper, but I seek some assurance here. I think basically the first part of my question is what, where will the money go to that is forthcoming from any penalties should they be imposed?
Well, income which arises from any of the monetary penalties imposed by SEPA, they will not be retained by SEPA to avoid the very low risk of penalties being issued for purely financial reasons. So I think it's set out in section 12 of the order that SEPA must pay any penalty received to Scottish ministers. So the Scottish ministers will thereafter pay any such penalties to the Scottish Consolidated Fund.
There will be no... I mean, I think that very nearly answers my question. I'm grateful for it. Because the hint was in the word you used there, the income raised. And I would hate this to be even have a possibility of becoming an income-raising mechanism. But in if I could just follow that up briefly, Convener, by any monies raised will go into the Scottish Consolidated Fund. Can you also assure us that that money raised will not be taken into account when determining SEPA's budget in following years?
Yes. It's going into the general, the wider Scottish Consolidated Fund, so it won't be attributed to SEPA, so we will not be doing any netting off exercise.
That's I'm very grateful for those replies. Thank you.
Fund.
And Jim Hume.
Yeah, thank you very much, Convener. Good morning to everyone. Back to Dave Thompson's point, I think you've clarified that the intention would be that an appellant who appeals and is an unsuccessful, SEPA would not automatically go for expenses against that appellant, who then, of course, would be facing a fine, and I believe. But it does say, or where the court considers that party has acted unreasonably, so therefore SEPA could go for getting their expenses back if that party had been deemed to act unreasonably. Of course, if that person had been unsuccessful in their appeal, they would then, of course, have been guilty of causing environmental damage. Therefore, would that be seen as being unreasonable? Therefore, I just wonder how strong the actual term means that the SEPA wouldn't be seeking costs.
The test of reasonableness is about behaviour. Is this an appeal that is completely ungrounded, that the appellant doesn't conduct themselves through the court in an appropriate fashion? It's not simply a question of whether you win or lose on the merits of the appeal. So if an appellant puts forward an appeal, a perfectly reasonable appeal, but the court nevertheless decides not to grant that appeal, that's not the sort of case where SEPA could even would seek or the court would grant expenses.
Okay, no, that's fine. Thanks.
Are there any other questions from members? If not, then I think we'll finish with this agenda item and move on to agenda item 3, which is to consider motion S4M 14575, asking for the committee to recommend approval of the affirmative instrument. The motion, of course, can be discussed for up to 90 minutes if we require to, but I think we've seen quite a lot of the questions answered, and of course it's the case now that only the Minister from the government's perspective can answer any points that are made, just to remind members. So I invite the Minister to speak and move the motion, which is Environmental Regulation Enforcement Measures Scotland Order 2015 draft.
Formally moved.
Thank you very much. Are there any members who wish to make any points? If not, Minister, do you wish to wind up?
No, I'm fine. Thank you very much, Convener.
Thank you. Well, I would put the question then. The question is that the motion S4M 14575 in the name of Aileen McLeod be approved. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. We will record that. Thank you very much, Minister, and your officials. And we'll have a brief suspension now to allow for a change over of witnesses. Cheers. So agenda item four this morning is to take evidence from representatives of the Crown Estate in Scotland on the organisation's annual Scotland report and an update on the devolution of the Crown Estate in Scotland, which includes the head of legal services to the Crown Estate from London, Rob Booth. Welcome to Gareth Baird, the Scottish Commissioner. Ronnie Quinn, General Manager, Scotland Portfolio and Head of Ocean Energy, and Alan Laidlaw, Rural and Coastal Portfolio Manager, and Rob Booth, the Head of Legal. I invite Gareth Baird, if he wishes to make any short opening statement, to do so. Good morning, gentlemen.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to the committee. Convener, thank you for inviting the Crown Estate to provide oral evidence to the committee and for allowing me to make some brief opening remarks. 11 months have passed since the publication of the Smith Commission report, which recommended devolution of the Crown Estate's management functions in Scotland. I've been Scottish Commissioner for over 6 years, and I can genuinely say in all that time I've had the highest respect and admiration for the Crown Estate team in Scotland. In many ways, the last 11 months has been the proudest spell of my tenure as Commissioner, the period in which I have seen the team at their finest. Our team in Scotland have continued to perform very strongly, day in and day out. And the Scotland Annual Report we published in June contains some examples of the great work they have been doing and indeed continue to do so. These positive results achieved in such a challenging and uncertain time for our business are a testament to the determination, dedication, expertise and resilience of our people. As well as the day job, the team have also been doing a power of work to prepare for the transition to the new body. We're still not sure exactly what that will be, and that body will inherit our responsibilities. Ronnie Quinn, seated next to me, has been appointed General Manager of our Scotland portfolio. a Scottish operating division with its own business plan, management information and financial reporting. This arrangement, which takes effect from the 1st of April 2016, is designed to ensure we are in the best shape possible to take forward the transition of the business, and that we play our part in delivering a prompt, smooth and seamless transition into the new devolved operation. I'm sure Ronnie will have the chance to explain our plans in more detail later in this session. Convener, I'm very proud of the results contained within the Scotland Annual Report, proud of the conscientious work we are doing to deliver devolution of our functions in Scotland, and proud of the way our staff have performed through a very challenging but successful year. I'm confident that our people will make a big success of whatever new devolved arrangements are introduced. And until that time comes, we will continue to perform strongly, and we will do all we can to minimise uncertainty for our customers, our staff and the communities we work with across Scotland. We're delighted to be here today to update you on our recent activities and achievements, and we will do all that we can to assist you in your deliberations. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that opening statement. We have a number of topics that people have thought to discuss, and the first of these is going to be led by Jim Hume.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to everyone this morning. Yes, you said there's been a power of work regarding the transition, and part of the concerns from some of the people we've talked to, particularly farming tenants, is regarding, obviously, management of the estate after devolution and, of course, throughout the whole transition period. I'm just wondering how much work has been done in that respect, where you see it going yourselves. Do you see it being devolved down to local authorities? Would you advise it going down to local authorities? You may not want to comment on that. Or would you see another body kept, obviously perhaps directly responsible to ministers? I'd be interested to hear your thoughts on where the power of work regarding the transition of farming tenancies is going.
Well, firstly, before I pass over to Alan Laidlaw here, I would say that the extent of devolution is entirely a matter for Scottish ministers. But as far as the communication we've had with our tenants, I'll let Alan extend on that.
Thank you, Gareth. Thank you, Convener, and good morning. There's a lot of uncertainty out there and I think that's probably been reflected in the evidence that's come to the committee, and I know you spend a lot of time out and about and get a lot of feedback, and as do we. And the key for us is to make sure that we're managing the uncertainty that we know about, and to make sure that business as usual is continued at the moment, but also try and make sure that there's a sensible approach to the more longer term side of things. I think I would say there'd be an element of reassurance in that there is change coming, but we're making sure that tenancy obligations and that side of things continue. And I think that's probably the piece where most people seek clarity quite quickly, and many are comforted by the fact that the protections given within the Ag Holdings Act or wherever their lease may sit would be protected. Where the difficulties probably come more often or not is when they're looking beyond transfer and seeking assurances about what may or may not happen. And that's where we are unable to offer, you know, any firm cast iron guarantees. But we are spending a lot of time talking to them and making sure they're aware of the process. I'm aware that the committee's had representation from some groups of tenants getting together, taking support and advice from NFUS, STFA and others, and making sure that they've got a voice through that process. And they're also involved in the ministerial stakeholder group as well to make sure that they have a good opportunity to influence going forward. So we're spending a lot of time making sure that they understand where in the process we are and when key decisions will be made and how they can influence those. So I think hopefully we're doing as much as we can there, but we will continue to do that as the process evolves.
For me, has there been any interaction with local authorities? Because I mean, some of the tenants, I believe, may be concerned if it is devolved to purely councillors, local authorities. There may not be the expertise within local authorities, and local authorities may not feel they they have the expertise themselves. I'm not sure about that.
In terms of the future decisions, as Gareth said, that's a matter for government. Both Ronnie and I have regular meetings with the councils. Indeed, the next round of those is starting. I think we can say we've got Orkney, Shetland, Highland, Argyll and Bute and Murray all booked in the diary in the next sort of 6 weeks. Indeed, I'm up to Murray on Friday morning to catch up on some of these elements. So,
thanks.
If I could just give a practical example to Mr. Hume of some interaction we had. About a fortnight ago, we were up on Glenlivet Estate. We've had a collaboration with the Morden Research Institute, which, just for the committee's information, is a world-leading animal disease research institute just out to the west of Edinburgh. And we brought the research scientists from the Morden together with our tenants, both on the Glenlivet and Fockabers estate, around animal disease and around animal productivity, a phrase that Alan often uses that we're trying to do with all our stakeholders is add value. And we went on to one of our tenants' farms with these research scientists, and there was a fantastic engagement between our farming tenants and these research scientists. So, if you like, there's been a frustration from the scientist side for the appliance of science, and this was allowing the scientists to get right at the coal face of animal issues, animal disease issues with our tenants. The level of interaction was absolutely superb. The Crown Estate sponsored that day. We had a seminar afterwards in the Glenlivet distillery. I may say that nothing was sampled, but the interaction, as I say, was absolutely amazing. I think perhaps a feature of our engagement with our tenants is every now and again our bolder tenants are confident enough to stand up and speak their mind. On that day, I had six tenants came to me very, very quietly and expressed their concerns about the future of what are multi-generational businesses. As Alan said, it's not possible for us to give them any black and white picture about that, but we just explained to them that the level of engagement between the Crown Estate team and Scottish Government ministers and officials is at a very high level, and to try and keep these assets performing at their best for the sake of Scotland and indeed for their own businesses was right at the top of the priority list.
Just to expand it slightly, that's good to hear, but obviously a lot of the talks will be happening at Westminster. I know we've got Rob Booth here as well. I just wonder how high up on the agenda this issue is in discussions with Westminster government on devolution of the...
I can confirm it is a topic of ongoing conversation. The nature of the process that we find ourselves involved in is that it effectively splits into two. So on the one side, we're ensuring that we're feeding into both Scottish Government and into Westminster at a technical level in relation to the legislation that's coming forwards. And at the other, frankly, I leave it to the experts to ensure that they are in with the stakeholder community having those sorts of interactions. But certainly there is information being passed in the Westminster direction as well as directly to stakeholders, as Gareth and Alan have spoken to.
Particularly regarding the farming tenants sector and
yes. Concerns.
Okay, thanks. Thanks.
Great day.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, gentlemen. First of all, can I very much welcome the level of detail in the 2015 report? I think it represents considerable progress on where we were 3-4 years ago. But can I refer you to page 22 in terms of the rural and forestry sector? Two things jump out at me. The first one is where there's reference to your conversion of the majority of limited partnerships into long-term limited duration tenancies. It says most of these tenancies are 15 years, some are for more than 30. I'm just interested to tease out, given the other work stream that we have at the moment, how you determine who should get a 30-year tenancy as opposed to a 15-year, and on what basis. And the second point I want to raise is you make reference to investing over £700,000 in tenants' units. Now, that's a considerable sum of money. However, it's been suggested to this committee that that process of repair and investment has to some degree been put on hold over the last period since it became apparent that control of the Crown Estate would be coming to Scotland. I just wonder how you react to that claim, that assertion, and if you dispute it, if you could perhaps give us examples of where investment has been taking place of late.
Absolutely. The easier question is the first one. In terms of the next generation tenancies, we took a view and looked at all of our limited partnerships a very long time ago, I think probably 8 years ago, and looked at LDTs and the development. And where we're looking to engage with the next generation in particular, rather than setting an arbitrary figure of 10, 15 or 20 years, we were looking at the business and the family or involved. So where longer tenancies were offered, we tended to take, and there's an element of arbitrary figure in there, the next generation up to 65. So if they were 40, it was a 25-year agreement. If they were 35, it was a 30-year agreement. And that is an element of arbitrary figure, but we thought at that time it was a useful discipline for family to say that's a good place for succession discussions to be happening, retirement planning, etc. So that's probably the main variance in terms of those discussions. That's meant that there's been some pretty very long-term, 35-year, 37-year-plus agreements where the next generation has been ready and able to move forward. I'm really proud of that and the team that work in there, because we're now three or four, at many occasions, probably more than that, years into those agreements. And the difference you see on the ground in terms of those discussions is significant. I think also in that regard, I think Gareth and I were mused on it when we were at Glenlivet at the time, that the age profile of many of our estates is significantly younger than you would maybe see elsewhere, because we are continuing to invest in fixed equipment and we are making sure that those succession discussions are happening. I can think of one tenant who got quite upset with me one day when I referred to him as the previous generation and we were looking to the next generation. That was two or three years ago. Now he says actually that was a really good moment in their family, because actually it gave their next generation a chance to say, what are we trying to achieve? In terms of investment, repairs expenditure this year is within 1% of last year. I looked at those figures over the last few days, so that the budget there is exactly the same. And indeed, additional funds have been made available this year to look at certain aspects of safety. So that would be electrical safety and asbestos. So we've got a programme of work to make sure that we are getting the estate fully in order in terms of that before any transfer. We are still investing capital into units. Indeed, I was down in Applegirth the other day, standing in front of a shiny galvanised shed where once stood a very archaic long barn system. So, there are examples there, and we're continuing to look at that. I think one of the differences at the moment is that there is a very clear point in time in the tenants' and our occupiers' minds that change will be happening. And many people have known that we've had a rolling programme of investment. Each year we take projects on, and they're uncertain as to whether or not that will continue or not. So I would suggest that quite often there is more projects have come forward in the last 6 months than previously probably came forward on average. So we are still investing. We can still give you examples of that. And we are taking our repair and maintenance obligations very seriously.
Thank you, Convener. Just to follow up on that, so what is the process of agreeing investment and repair? And if someone is dissatisfied by being told it's not happening or you have to wait 2 years, how do you take that forward?
I think with anyone who's maintaining assets, whether it be a residential property or a commercial office block, there's always things that need to be done. So we have a dialogue. We try and communicate as openly as we can, and we try and make sure that the budget's set work and we approve our work plans. In areas such as Murrayshire, particularly Glenlivet, the window for putting up new steel and concrete's relatively limited. I can think of one or two examples where we're working and the tenants have said to us, mid-October to mid-May, we're just not interested. Let's agree the budget for the following financial year, get planning in place and look to move forward post-turnout of stock. So it's a dialogue. I think probably separate the repairs discussion from investment discussion. We try and do as much as we can when it's due, and we try and retain sensible contingencies for weather events. So Port Gordon Harbour, our expenditure last year went up by over £400,000 because of an extreme weather event in Port Gordon the year before, and probably 4 or 5 years ago, the significant snowfalls in Murrayshire, again, there's £1 million expenditure happened the year that occurred. So we have, you know, we try and retain some flexibility to be able to respond to needs on the ground.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Alec Ferguson, did you have a point?
No, I'm happy at this stage, convener. Thank you.
Very good. We'll move offshore then. Sarah Boyack.
Thanks very much and good morning. I really wanted to explore where we're going on offshore, particularly in terms of renewables, and the Crown Estate's obviously instrumental in getting that whole set of technology going because of your infrastructure and your influence over, I think it's half the foreshore in Scotland, which is, it's a lot of land. And I really wanted to get a sense of where that's going in the future. Your renewables investment's up 5% this year, and I think it's a key devolution challenge to keep all of that going and yet see more benefits for local communities coming through that process. I wonder if you could talk a little bit more about that. I mean, I noticed that MayGen is pretty well on the way. It's just to get a sense of what more is going to be coming next and how you're going to manage your way through the devolution process on that.
Thank you and good morning. Yes, you're quite right to pick out the MayGen project as being a flagship project, if you like, for tidal energy globally, I have to say. And members may be aware that the cables for that first array were laid over the last couple of months. So that's progressing well. What perhaps isn't as well known is the smaller project in Blue Mill Sound in Shetland, where cables again have been laid for that over the last couple of months, and indeed the kit has been laid on the seabed in respect of that. So not all the eggs are in the one basket there. You know, the ocean energy projects are moving ahead and being installed as we speak. We're continuing to invest in studies. A key one here is going to be the Sparta study, where we've got every UK offshore wind farm that's operating is now feeding into this project. And what that's doing is providing a benchmark for the operation and maintenance of offshore wind farms. And that's very useful, particularly for new entrants and for those existing in the field, to be able to benchmark themselves against what can be achieved and what can be expected, and what, frankly, is good practice and what's not good practice. And that's really key to bringing down the levelised cost of energy and bringing down the operations and maintenance costs. So that's been a key significant programme over the last few years, in fact. And I say we're really pleased that now every operating offshore wind farm is now contributing to that. Aside from that, we've been publishing data on our own marine data exchange, and that's now the largest collection of offshore wind speed and direction data that's available. And again, looking forward, particularly on the ocean energy side, last month, in fact, we brought forward a new way of or a new form of leasing for particularly small-scale, up to 3 megawatts devices for tidal current and for wave energy. And that's not been done as a window basis, but that's been kept open. And that should mean that there's a process available when the developers are ready to go forward. Not they don't have to wait for us opening a window anymore. It's there and ready for them to use when it's available. We've also taken steps to simplify the documentation around about that and make it an awful lot simpler. One of the big things, again, associated with that is reduction in the number of milestones that small developers in particular had to achieve. That's been reduced from 18 to about 2. And that should reduce the bureaucracy both for the developers and indeed for the Crown Estate in managing those to make sure that that's possible. So looking ahead in the offshore wind side, members will be aware that there will be a few crunchy decisions that have to be taken by offshore wind developers this financial year. And we're working with them to assist in those coming forward as timeously as we can. And there are other projects where the outcome of the, or the announcement, forthcoming announcement in respect of the auction, next auction for contract for differences, is going to be key. And again, we're supporting some of the Scottish projects in their deliberations in respect of that. I think I'm still convinced that offshore wind has a significant part to play in the energy mix going forward. I think Scotland's got a significant part to play in that. On the ocean energy side, we're continuing to do what we can to push that industry further forward. The Maygen and the Blue Mill Sound site with Nova Innovations are going to be key in driving forward technical innovation, operational innovation, and that in itself will, it's hoped, increase investor confidence, and that will, should become a virtuous circle going forward, and we'll play our part to the utmost in making that happen.
I think that's a really useful overview. I mean, I suppose you mentioned you had a phrase which is quite a good one, the crunchy decision time coming up, and this year is absolutely crucial given the big setback, some of us should say, at the UK level. You've mentioned the Scottish Investment Bank. There's the Green Investment Bank. In the report you mentioned the role that the Scottish Investment Bank is playing in the Methil project. There's still the Green Investment Bank and the Scottish Government itself. Is there more that can be done to actually make sure those projects don't fall by the wayside or become things that are parked just because of the current financial uncertainty? Is there work the Scottish Government could do? I know we've had support for marine rocks in the past that was a slightly larger support mechanism than in the rest of the UK. Are there key things that we could do in Scotland just to make sure that investment actually comes through?
Speaking to developers, they are very welcoming of the support that the Scottish Government has in the past been given. I mean, the consistency of messaging in respect of offshore renewables and offshore wind has been noticed and is very much appreciated by the industry. I think maintenance of that, I think, is key going forward. Difficulty here is always going to be confidence, and that level of confidence that the Scottish Government, that level of support that the Scottish Government has always given, I think is key to keeping the offshore wind developers engaged and willing to invest the significant sums of money required to develop these projects.
Just a final supplementary. We've kind of focused on the really big projects going forward, which are absolutely crucial for the future of our economy and our environment. But you did mention in passing small-scale leasing changes. I wonder if there's a way of getting that communicated more widely, what opportunity is there? And are you doing work with Cooperative Development Scotland to look at co-op models, which I know have really taken off in the community renewable sector?
We were very keen to speak about this at the recent Scottish Renewables Marine Energy Conference in Inverness. We had the full team up there speaking to the industry and the players, and we have had 20 expressions of interest, I believe, already. And I think that's a healthy thing. But if members are aware of other ways that we can push this further forward, it's on our website, but we're happy to speak to people about that and new developers about that. And I have to say, we have dialogues with new developers very, very regularly about the opportunities and what they can do. And one of the key things now, as I've mentioned, is the process is now there and ready for them when they are ready. So we're not having a stampede of applications just because there's a finite window at this particular point in time. But as I say, if members are aware of any other project that's out there, then please ask them to speak to us.
Angus McDonald.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, everyone. Staying with future energy initiatives, I have a constituency interest in carbon capture and storage, so I was pleased to see it received some prominence in the report. I'm interested in particular with Summit Power's Captain Clean Energy project, which proposes up to 90% carbon capture from a 500 megawatt clean coal plant. Now, a note in the report that there's no mention of that particular project. However, there is mention of the CO2 injections to the Captain aquifer under the Central North Sea. So I'm just curious as to whether there's continuing dialogue with Summit Power and other project partners, and are you confident that such an exciting project can be delivered? And also, we've also heard that there's the auction for contracts for difference. Will that have any bearing on whether the project goes forward or not?
Number of points there. I'll try and capture them, but if I miss any, no doubt you can remind me. As to ongoing dialogue with regard to the Inner Firth of Forth, there's a meeting, it's either next week or the week after, where a number of stakeholders are coming together, including ourselves. We've been very active in bringing the key participants together. There'll be ourselves, representatives from Scottish Government, from DEC, as well as industry there, trying to take a number of initiatives further forward. Key to that would be carbon capture and storage for some of those things. One of the other areas where we've been active this year and published a report is in respect of the interactions between injections into a CO2 storage site and multiple injections and how that would work. And I think, again, that's an enabler for that Captain Clean project to go forward. We're aware of the Shell interest in the Goldeneye site, and that, again, is one of these ones where we're expecting financial decisions to be taken towards the end of this financial year. So carbon capture and storage is a very exciting part of the overall picture. Will CFDs play a significant part in that? Yes, they will, because again, these investments will require a significant amount of capital to take them forward, CapEx to go forward. And again, the boards making those decisions for those investments will be looking very closely at the CFD regime and their access to that for those investment decisions. If I've missed anything.
No, I think that covers it. Thanks. Yeah.
I will stay offshore then at the moment. Claudia Beamish.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to you, Commissioner, and to your colleagues today. Having been on the committee when the Aquaculture Bill went through the committee and became an act, as we all know, I would be interested if whoever it's appropriate to ask the question to could say something about the developments, because I see that you're leasing... there is the leasing of 850 sites, and that members of the Crown Estate staff sit on the various forums which have been set up, both to help drive the industry forward and also to ensure that we have appropriate marine environmental protections, and of course develop local economies, which can often be quite fragile. So I'm wondering if there are any... The report is very helpful in addressing the research that you're doing and various other issues. I'm wondering if there are any concerns particularly, but if you wanted to make any more broad comments, any concerns in terms of environmental protection as we go forward, or if you feel reasonably comfortable about the sustainable targets.
Thank you. I was discussing aquaculture the other day internally and asked what my team were up to, and I said sort of business as usual. So there's been a lot of change, even probably 7 or 8 years ago, and other members of the committee remember various calls for change to consenting the regimes through aquaculture industry. The industry's in good health. They still very aspirational growth targets, still major contributor to Scotland's food and drink sector, and from my point of view, that rural communities and that employment sector. I think the business as usual aspect is probably that they're continuing to deliver. The industry is in probably a period of consolidation. There's still all of the vagaries of producing a world-class food product in a wild environment with the vagaries of international competition, weather, food, disease, pestilence, etc., you know, all these challenges. But they continue to deliver year on year. One of the biggest and most regular, probably, feedback issues we get is consenting and the challenges involved in that process, and making sure that there's a streamlined process through Government, Marine Scotland, and their licensing through and through all the other aspects, including town and country planning, which all of the issues that you rehearsed through some of the discussions that it went through. So as one of those actions was actually raised at one of our Scottish liaison subgroups, where we get the industry together and say, you know, how pretty much the same question you've just asked us, we say to the industry, what's happening, what's going on, where are the challenges? And I think consenting would probably have come through loud and clear. So with that in mind, we're working with Scottish Government on a consenting review to look at a sort of independent review of how that structure works and where any key trigger points or barriers might be, with a view to trying to make that as simple as possible. So I think that aquaculture continues to be a really important sector. There's a lot of detailed work going on with change of consenting regimes and that side of things, but the industry would be probably in a period of consolidation following change and still wanting to significantly grow. There's still, you know, big growth targets that the industry support, and I know that government have talked a lot about them as well, and I see that continuing, but we have to remember that they're operating in a pretty challenging market at all times.
Right, thank you. So, is what you're saying, I don't want to put words into your mouth, but you don't have particular environmental concerns coming from your sites. I mean, you're putting research into looking at jellyfish blooms, I see in the report. But I'm not going to re-rehearse here the issues that came up in relation to the biomass and all the different issues around sea lice, which none of the committee like to mention, but we have to face that there's conflicting research on, you know.
There's a strong view on all aquaculture issues regarding that. We are not the regulator of aquaculture, and but what we're trying to do is make sure where development comes up that it can be achieved in a sustainable fashion. And for aquaculture, I think sustainable development goes so widely, you know, into whether it be the river systems and the loch systems, the sea systems, into the communities and schools and everything like that. So there's so much to be there. And I think what we've done for a very long time in the aquaculture sector, whether it be the shellfish or the salmon sector, is recognise that we're able to bring a strategic level approach to look at things on a national basis in exactly the same way as Ronnie talked about the energy side, making sure there's good data out there to allow correct decisions. And I think that's the key role that we would continue to play. And to be able to look at those sort of challenges on the ground at a much higher level to see how can we achieve this. Because I think in many of the areas in marine planning, you can end up being very insular to the small area of interest to a consenting body, to an organisation who wants to take something forward, or to a community. And what we try and do is make sure that expertise is looked at a more strategic level. And that's what we should continue to do. The algal blooms thing can affect any area at any time. So let's do that at a national level rather than one small area trying to be looking at it. And I think that would be our approach. And I think that's where industry see the greatest benefit from us and give positive feedback on that. So I think the environmental challenges will always be there, and they need to be discussed. And hopefully we can inform some of those discussions by keeping those at a strategic sort of level.
Thank you.
Mike Russell.
Yeah, let me ask you about the practical devolution of some of your powers to communities. I mean, I'm very familiar, I know many of you are, with the work in Tobermory and with the Harbour Association. It seems to me that that's a pretty good model of, actually illustrates something on the front of your annual report, working together for shared success. How do you build upon that model and where else could you apply it? And then I want to put that into the mix with the possible devolution of powers to local authorities themselves, which might get in the way of doing that.
I think examples like Tobermory, where there's a really strong constituted group that work very well, have got, you know, you've taken evidence from Brian and the team from Tobermory. I think our relationship extends back to 2002, you know, and it's been an iterative sort of process where phases, I think we're in phase six being discussed now. And to me, that's really simple. You've got a well-constituted group that know what they're trying to achieve, are au fait with working with different bodies for that shared success. That's very simple. I think the LMAs, local management agreements that we talk about, they're another iteration of that, and where local communities and operators can say, look, we've got an interest in an area and we want to take something forward in a staged sort of process. And I think that works well. We've talked in the past about mooring associations, whereby a collective group of those interested in a certain area can form together, bringing economies of scale, organisation, maritime sort of navigational safety, and actually far better management on the ground. So those are all examples of where it works well, and it tends to be a well-organised group with common interests, probably, where it develops best. And I think that's always been something that we've looked to try and achieve, having good local management and well-structured and agreed. And that's the same when we talk to all our historic dealings with the councils and local authorities in terms of master agreements and things like that, to say, look, let's have a framework agreement that does that. And I think we can continue that. In terms of devolution to local authorities, again, it's probably not something that I can comment on, because I think that's still a matter up for discussion. I think what you need to make sure in a marine sense is that people who understand the local areas are involved, and that's where our greatest successes have been to date.
That seemed to be, maybe this is for Gareth rather than anybody else, but there does seem to be a bit of a dichotomy between the desire of some people, to be blunt, to get their hands on your revenue, you know, and I mean, the Coastal Communities Fund, although I have criticism how it was set up, has actually been very useful for coastal communities in Scotland. Local authorities are short of cash and are looking to get revenue. So there's a dichotomy between trying to get their people's hands on the revenue you produce and the issue of the powers that you have and the ability you have to invest and have done in the longer term within communities in order to benefit those communities. Now, I suppose what I'm saying to you is I hope that that thinking is within your own minds as you have conversations with local authorities who are keen to enhance their powers, so that they're talking about the right use of those powers at the level in which they can make a difference.
It's a very fair point, and here's the conundrum in the utilisation of these assets in particular in the coastal communities for their benefit. I think what sits alongside that, as you've rightly identified, is how do we take that forward? Because clearly there's liabilities around these assets. Some of the assets, the seabed is just extraordinarily complex with a whole heap of commercial interests around that, and indeed community and environmental interests around that. I think the role that we can best play in that, certainly, as I said before, and this is not me falling away from it, the level of devolution is absolutely for discussion between Scottish ministers and local authorities. What I'm very convinced about and very determined about is that the expertise of this team helps inform decisions about how that would go on and how the management would go on for that. Where the revenue flows, as a minister for government and local authorities to discuss, as long as we can keep these assets performing and to go back to that phrase, adding value to them, and that's not just financial value, then the team will have done their job.
If there is, in development, a devolved structure, that keeps the expertise of the Crown Estates together, then you are obviously an agnostic in terms of how the revenue runs, with the exception of the ability to continue to run a profitable business which allows continued investment for the future. That would be a summary of where you are. Could I then ask you that when you think about going forward, you also look carefully at the role of your agents? Because although I rarely get direct complaints about you, I do get complaints about your agents. Now, that may be inevitable, but it is important that communities feel empowered and communities feel able, that's a point of, one of the points of devolution, to engage with you as an organisation. And if agents stand between you and that organisation and perhaps do things that cannot be understood, then that makes life more difficult for everybody.
I absolutely accept that, Mr. Russell. And indeed, we have worked very hard to educate our agents on how we would expect them to carry out their business. I think they have moved forward. Every now and again, we're going to get a rogue incident that happens. As you know, I'm a tenant farmer myself, so when you inject the word landlord, the temperature goes up. When you put the other word agent in amongst it, it starts getting a bit volcanic. So we're very sympathetic to that. And as we move forward in the management of these assets, because the resource within the Bellsbury office isn't sufficient to carry out on all these on-the-ground negotiations and, you know, an overview of how these assets are performing. So that function will be needed to carry out by somebody somewhere, and going forward to get people in the right mindset to carry out that function is going to be really important. I'm confident we can do that, and Alan's got much more experience of this than me.
I think the key to that is to make sure that we have the right people doing the right things. And the evidence sessions that you've had in previous, you know, you had Elgar Finlay from Glendale, Brian Swinbank, who you're very familiar with, they tend, so those initial projects tend to be met with agents and my team together. And indeed today, the coastal team are in Caithness in Sutherland. They were up there yesterday with the agents in partnership. If we look back at the LMAs and the foreshore sales pilots, all of those kickoff meetings have tended to be initial contact, either direct into us through maybe one of yourselves or an elected member or to an agent, and then the first initial proper meaty discussions done with both agent and team members in there. And I think that's the key. I think managing agents as a general subject that the committee is hearing a lot about at the moment, we work really closely with our agents to make sure that they know where we're heading, our direction of travel. A lot of the work that I've been doing over the last few months has been about how that is taken to the next level. We've been engaging with Scottish Land Estates and Community Land Scotland about advice to agents. I've been involved in the Million Acre Target Working Group on the barriers to supply of land and that side of things. And I think that whole dynamic is something that we've actually worked very hard on and have produced guidelines for our agents. And I noticed with interest that Forestry Commission and Forest Enterprise issued some stuff yesterday that I thought looked very familiar, and it was good to see. And I look forward to working with CLS and others and to make sure that the agents do understand what's to be achieved on the ground. And that point that you make about mutual success is genuinely something that our agents do understand.
Very reassuring. Could I just make one final, more general point? Mr. Booth and I have crossed swords on a previous occasion about Fort Kinnaird. If I may take a motto from elsewhere, I do hope in the process of devolution that the Crown Estate in Scotland, that what you have, you will hold, and there will be no diminution of assets during the process of devolution.
Do you want to address that on the rural and coastal side? Or?
I think what we're trying to do is run the business going forward, as we've always done it, and that has had an element of wheeling and dealing, an element of moving things and selling assets and buying assets, and I see that going forward as part of the business as usual process, to be honest.
The overall value of the portfolio, and you are good stewards of that value, does not diminish. I mean, we put Fort Kinnaird to one side. I think that's a fix, and not one that Scotland shouldn't be happy about. But that taken to one side, you have a valuable set of assets which should be put to work for the future of Scotland.
Yes, there's certainly no intention to undermine that value, but that's not to say there won't be dealings going forward. It's part of the business.
I understand that. Graham, sorry, well, Claudia Beamish has a question. Is it about offshore?
Thank you.
And Graham Day has, so we'll take Claudia first and then Graham, because I think it's...
Thanks, Convener.
It's a small point.
Sorry?
It's a small point, I believe.
I see, Commissioner, from the report that it's highlighted that you said, if I may quote it, a personal highlight as my role as Commissioner has been the success of local management agreements and the adoption of many community ideas and initiatives. I mean, I know it's not only a numbers game, but we followed this on committee for, others have been much longer than I have, but I have for the last 4 years, and it would be very helpful to have some detail, if not now, in writing about how the local management agreements are developing and the numbers and something about the community initiatives as well. And I don't know if you or any of the staff wish to comment at this point briefly on that.
Well, we'd be delighted to provide you with details on that. If I can just give you a personal view on that back end, I think. So time's running together. We were up at Loch Maddy at the opening of their new pontoons, and the injection of business and visitors into that small community has just been quite extraordinary. And we had a great day getting it open. This really was a community initiative driven very hard by very able people and actually a local landlord who had invested very heavily in it as well. The figures that are very blunt that struck me, there's a wee village shop during the season. Their weekly income had gone up by £1,000. And the local hotel had gone up by £3,000 a week, and they were able to convert 3 part-time jobs to 3 full-time jobs in that wee community. That is, you know, great stuff. And funnily enough, the marine leisure tourism, which, as you know, is so successful in Scotland and these fragile communities, in the last 2 months of the season, they had over 300 yachts into to really see what the new facility was like. So it was, you know, it was a real quantum leap for that community, and to see that that delivery in there from their initiative was enormously fulfilling for all of us.
If I can just add on that, I think that's a really good example where the strategic meets the local. Gareth talked about the marine sort of tourism side of things. We've got the marine tourism strategy was launched. There's a debate in the chamber about that. It's awakening the giant. There's a marine leisure symposium next month. And that's where taking a really high-level approach to marine tourism to show the value to Scotland. The figures quoted on page 21 talk about 3,000 jobs in leisure and tourism in the marine sector. But at the Loch Maddy example, is, you know, somebody taking a very local idea and using an LMA to progress it, and we invested. The Glendale Trust, Elgar Finlay, who you've had in front of you before, was literally standing at his community saying, I can now see the next point in the marine tourism strategy across the water, and we need to make sure we've got proper linkages. And in the past, it's been at times communities have competed to say, well, we've got facilities and next door haven't. Actually, they're being far more strategic to say, how do we make sure that you can sail from Loch Maddy down to Skye and be suitably looked after and accommodated? And I think, from my point of view, that's something I get a lot out of, is that seeing those connections. We're now talking about the Cool Routes initiative across Europe, you know, and that whole marine leisure strategy is starting to really piece together. And when there's a single engagement at the Community Land Scotland AGM that I was at, talking to somebody who had never heard of the marine leisure strategy, and seeing the excitement and the realisation that their project could connect into something very quickly and start moving at a pace that they probably didn't think was achievable, to me, just showed that that connection of strategic and local really makes a big difference. And I think it's really exciting.
Thank you.
Being called We Are Sailing. Graham Day.
Thank you, Kavira. I want to sort of roll back a little bit, taking the sailing theme. I appreciate that you can't really talk about the role that you think the Crown Estate ought to have going forward. But I want to explore briefly what you're capable of doing, or an element of that. When we talk about devolving control and power down to local authority level, I think many of us would like to see it go beyond that and very much be concentrated in the communities. Now, one of the arguments against that that will be put forward is, well, perhaps the communities don't have the capacity to take on that role. But it strikes me, and I'd welcome your comments on this, the expertise of the Crown Estate with these local management agreements, that engagement with the communities, you know what it takes to see that delivered. I just would welcome your thoughts on whether there might be, in theory and principle, a role for the Crown Estate in its new guise to proactively be helping to build capacities into these communities that want to take control of the assets so that they do become empowered to do it, they have the ability to do it.
If I could just kick that off, I really hope so. And Alan will have much more experience of.
I think community capacity is something that some people understand and others don't even know it exists. We have a team of people, whether it be within the team, with the agents and our partners, who understand how to get the most out of communities. And that's what floats my boat. It genuinely does. I can think of one example within the report, Port Gordon Harbour, some fairly difficult discussions. You know, I was summoned to their meeting, and they were pretty keen that I came and pretty clear about what the message was. And that was an initially difficult discussion, which has now entered into a proper community led full village engagement about the art of the possible. So from pretty frosty beginnings to early but green shoots of proper engagement throughout that community, to me, shows that the people, the team, the engagement that we've done has helped. And that is what our team are very good at. There are other teams around, and there are partner bodies and bodies that you're all familiar with that do that well. And all I want to make sure is that those opportunities can still grow. And I'll leave the politics to the politicians.
Okay.
I think I'd like to turn to just a point on your agents or your staff visiting places. I heard Caithness and Sutherland there in my constituency. Obviously civil servants and, you know, development agencies visit people all the time. I don't know whether you might consider, informing local members about, you know, impending visits that are of use, because it would be invaluable to us to know what's going on. And I make that in a very general sense, because obviously the day-to-day things are what normally happens. But anyway, I make that point just now.
One of the things that in particular coastal agents do is record all of their engagements, and actually giving you a picture and summary of that would probably be useful. The offer continues to the committee to, if people want to engage with us on specific projects, happy to come and do that, or if you want to see anything. And indeed, we will try and keep you abreast of developments. Mr. Russell, I can tell our aquaculture team are on the ground in your constituency at the end of this week and all of next week. I know that for a fact. They're on Mull looking at some issues. But we will try and do our best to informally make sure members know exactly what's going on the patch. I would say that they are out and about a huge amount, and I suspect one or two of you might get bored of an email from me saying, just so you know, they're on the ground. But I think for key engagements, we'd be very happy to do so.
Okay, right. I'd like to turn to some questions that haven't been asked so far. I'm thinking about the balance sheet and so on, but also about some of the strategic issues going forward. Thinking about the balance sheet, you point out that, indeed, the property values have decreased because of the sale of coastal residential properties and rural residential properties, for example. I think last time you were talking about some foreshore rights being sold as well. Is that included in the loss of value of assets?
No. The Carloway Estate Trust undertook a pilot foreshore sale purchase, and it would be significantly further to the right in the numbers, in terms of number of zeros involved, than would be represented in any change in value. The numbers were very, very small. So that's the only foreshore sale that's gone through very well, but it was a very de minimis amount.
I was going to move on to a much bigger part of the overall balance, and it's a question I've asked Ronnie Quinn before this, in terms of the way in which you might estimate the income from offshore assets in particular. You've come up in the past with formulae that perhaps show us what you can expect. So it's in two parts. Can you update us on that formula, for example, for offshore wind? But secondly, how does your projection then become part of your planning for the next part of your developments of the assets that you hold in the coming years? We've heard about investments on the landward estates, but how does that projection affect the way in which you think about your own investments?
I'm happy to say that the numbers I've given the committee and yourself in the past, convener, are still the same. So the formula for example, for round three remains roughly in the region of about £7.6 million per gigawatt that's generating. For non-round three, so that would be the STW sites, it's about £4.3 million per gigawatt that's generating. Those are estimated at 2020 values. For wave and tidal devices, it's something in the region of about 30k per annum for each 10 megawatts, scaling that down. So far as that revenue is concerned in our ongoing planning, it really only has an impact in respect of targets that are met. The actual revenue in the way that the Crown Estate operates is currently put into Her Majesty's Treasury. So it doesn't form part of the ongoing estate. So the revenue is just a revenue stream. It's passed through to Her Majesty's Treasury. Going forward, those revenues would transfer into Scottish ministers for their disbursement thereafter. So that those increases in revenue of themselves don't become a significant part in the planning. Obviously, however, we have to take a longer term view in the growth of ongoing revenue to meet ongoing targets. And I would expect that going forward, the new body may be given targets to meet by Scottish ministers. And it would be at that stage you then look forward to what's likely to be expected, how we'd meet those expectations, and then taking that further forward, how we're likely to generate additional revenue to meet those targets. And that traditionally within the Crown Estate has been quite a long-term investment.
Okay, on that point, Sarah Boyack.
Sorry, it was to follow up once you finished your questions. Okay, all right. To get in the queue.
It's not about that. Okay, well, I want to continue on my line of arguments about projecting forward. Has the Crown Estate been thinking about how it might alter its salmon fishery activities or mineral policy with regard to the way in which the devolved assets may well pan out? Have you been thinking forward in those areas about how they might be managed? I noticed, for example, that it's said to have been a dry year or something like that, so therefore there were lower catches in the salmon fishing side.
All of the operations that I look after for rural and coastal are looked at on a Scottish basis, and we're always making sure that we take long-term decisions. So even before Smith as a vehicle and a discussion was occurring, we would be doing 5, 10 and beyond year planning as to what that would look like. So yes, we've always given thought as to how that might look in the future. And as I say, keen keen to be make sure that those assets continue to produce. To use Mr. Russell's comments, that what we have will continue to hold and it will continue to deliver, I think, is my main aspect of that side of things. You pick on salmon fishings and fisheries and mines, oil or minerals. Both are significantly challenged sectors for different reasons. Wild fish and climatic conditions on the river is having quite a big impact, in terms of catch numbers and that side of things. In terms of minerals, the construction elements and boom and coal and all that sort of stuff has other impacts. So both of those are probably more at the vagaries of variables that are out with the control than probably rural, coastal, and even to a slightly lesser extent aquaculture. But we're always considering what they can offer long term, and I would like to see those assets continue to deliver what they're able, but they are limited and with some challenges.
Mike Russell has a
minerals issue. I probably you can't answer this here, but I'd be quite interested to hear from you if there's a difference of approach to minerals on your land in Scotland than you would have in the rest of the UK. And I ask the question because Scotland does not have, and I believe should have, a modern piece of modern minerals legislation, whereas minerals legislation is different in other areas. I would be interested just to know what the policy situation is, because it will have a bearing going forward in terms of what the possibilities are.
I mean, our mineral operations, I used to be responsible on a UK-wide basis and I'm pretty familiar with them. There are different legislations. Other than Mines Royal, we have limited mineral exploration opportunities in the assets that we have onshore at the moment. But still, as a duty to get best value, we need to make sure that we identify
something from you, if that's possible. Yeah,
happy to
just understand. And also, obviously, these are assets that need to be thought about. And modern minerals legislation in other parts of Europe, for example, treats them in a very sympathetic and environmental way, but countries do get more out of them than we get.
Yeah. An interesting point. From the point of view of Rob Booth, you have come along, I think, with it. Just to ask a question here. Thinking forward... Thinking about the assets which we've been talking about in terms of those which are part of the scheme to devolve, would you see any difficulties with the fact that there's variables? We can see that the property values have gone down, but as long as the Crown Estate is making a profit, then that's generally meeting the spirit of the 1961 Act. Part of the discussion in the Devolution Further Powers Committee and with the Treasury about the question about the removal of particular assets from the portfolio. Have you any further comments about that for us just now that might elucidate?
And thank you for the question, as an initial point to make, and actually Gareth referred to it earlier, we are putting in place some new structuring in relation to how management of assets, particularly in Scotland, is undertaken, with Ronnie taking lead responsibility for that and reporting directly to our CEO in relation to discharging what will be a separate business plan looking specifically at those assets going forwards. At the moment, in relation to Scottish assets, we as an organisation have a UK-wide obligation to balance enhancing value and the return from them across all of our asset classes, which, is that to Scotland's disadvantage? Well, it depends on the market, it depends on the opportunities, it depends on what the right thing to do with those assets from time to time is. Going forward, there is, I think, an advantage to a Scotland-specific body, the Scottish manager, whatever name Scottish Government decide to give that organisation, being able to look specifically at Scotland and not having to weigh that against a wider holistic assessment of everything that's going on a UK-wide basis. That it's undoubtedly a more polarised and probably an easier way to look at it than doing that balancing exercise. But certainly, as regards the split of assets is probably not the right way to describe it necessarily, but the devolution of our functions in relation to the Scottish economic assets in Scotland, I don't think there's been a substantial move forward in relation to that, except to make sure that And you know, since the last time I appeared here, we've been doing a lot of work with representatives of Scottish Government to talk them through what the assets are, what the current constitution of the Crown Estate requires as regards the conduct of those assets, and things like decommissioning responsibilities and some of the other responsibilities that sit around them. But as to the actual ambit of what is transferring, I'm not aware that that's shifted.
I was just concerned about this idea about no detriment, which you know, has been discussed in terms of the Crown Estate assets and also the wider questions of the devolved powers in the Scotland, proposed Scotland bill that's going through Westminster at the moment, and that it would be up to the Scottish managers of the Scottish assets to decide how to deploy them.
Absolutely. Use of and management of those Scottish assets going forward, subject to the caveat that I spoke to last time in relation to the underlying sovereign ownership of those assets, is entirely for the Scottish manager to work going forwards. And you know, to that extent, there is potential perhaps to do more with that focus on Scottish assets than we're currently able to do under our existing legislation.
Well, we'll look forward to that debate in due course. Sarah Boyack.
Thank you very much, Convener. I want to follow up the issue of Scottish assets by just clarifying what Scottish assets actually are. And I want to pursue the issue of Fort Kinnaird. So I want to move us into urban Scotland. We've been talking rightly a lot about rural Scotland. And it's really following up information we've got from the Cabinet Secretary about how we define where Fort Kinnaird sits, because I think previously when we asked the question about it's in Scotland, why isn't it transferred to whatever becomes the new management structure in Scotland, we were told that although it's in Scotland, it's not actually part of the Crown Estate because of all the complex legal ownership issues. And I think we understand that. And yet the restriction on the transfer that would stop Fort Kinnaird coming to the new entity in Scotland actually describes it as part of the Crown Estate. Does that not kind of defeat the argument that even though it's not wholly owned by the Crown Estate has an interest in it and the property actually is in Edinburgh? So has there been any progress about that? Because it's quite a big chunk of property that would make a great deal of sense to sit in the property portfolio in Scotland, notwithstanding the fact that it's not wholly owned by the Crown Estate.
Certainly, I was aware of the reference. I mean, I guess there's a degree here to which semantics is perhaps slightly unhelpful in relation to describing an asset, a part of the Crown Estate, an economic asset in Scotland. From our perspective, looking at it from a technical analysis, our interest is directly in the English Limited Partnership. And that English Limited Partnership owns multiple properties, one of which is in Scotland. So you know, is our interest in the ELP part of the Crown Estate? Yes, it absolutely is, and it's something that we manage. Are the shareholdings that sit around that wider structure a part of the Crown Estate? Well, yes, again, they are, because they are things that via the holding structure, and hopefully which came through clearly in the fact sheet that we followed up our last appearance with, that they are Crown Estate assets. The question here is whether Fort Kinnaird is an economic asset managed by the commissioners in Scotland. And the answer to that, on the basis of the structure that's there and the construction of Smith that we certainly are confident in our reading of it, would conclude that Fort Kinnaird as a Scottish property, and there's no dispute about it being a Scottish property, isn't an economic asset managed by the commissioners in Scotland.
No, it isn't currently. Totally accept that. We're just talking about what happens next. When we do get devolution, it's certainly a huge economic asset in the area, and it's people in the area that are generating that economic asset by using the retail park. I just wanted to keep it back on our agenda, Convener.
Was it on the same point, Claudia?
No, it's a short new point.
It's a new point, right. Well, Graham Day was first and then yourself.
Thank you, Convener. As we discussed today, these are uncertain times for everybody connected with the Crown Estate, not least of all the staff. I'm conscious that it must be very unsettling for some of you guys and your colleagues. I'm assuming that as we're moving forward and transitioning to the new arrangements, there will be dialogue going on between the management of the Crown Estate and the Scottish Government about how the new body might look, what roles it might take on, operational practices, etc. I'd just like to be satisfied that as that's happening, and I'm assuming it is, that your staff are being given an opportunity to feed into that process, to shape the new arrangements? Is there some mechanism there that allows them to say, well, we actually think this could work better if we did X, Y, or Z?
Thank you. Yes, very valid point. You're quite right to identify that there is a degree of uncertainty amongst the staff just now. We're doing what we can to mitigate that level of uncertainty. As an example, we got a letter in yesterday from the Scottish Government advising us about some future happenings. That was sent out to all the staff members this morning, frankly, so that they're aware of it as soon as we could make that available. So far as the staff inputting to it, we're keen to work with the staff on that and with the unions, it has to be said. And as luck would have it, we've got another session on Monday where we get all the Scottish staff together and go through what's happening. We go through where we are, and Monday's session, in fact, has a bit about business planning and how we shape this going forward. So, we're doing as much as we hope we can to keep the staff engaged and involved in this. But we're aware that this is a difficult time. It's a time of uncertainty. We're bringing in external consultants to assist with well-being and with robustness and stress, etc. So that's an ongoing process. We're very conscious of that impact and how that has the potential to impact the staff. And the results that we've had this last year, as Gareth says, are really a testament to the professionalism of the staff, that they're doing the day job and getting on with that in what are uncertain times. I won't say anything other than that. Almost every meeting we have with tenants, with developers, with stakeholders, there's an element of and what's happening next, and the staff are dealing with that on a daily basis. So they're as well informed as they can be, I think.
Thank you.
Convener, I wonder if I could just add to Mr. Day just my own personal perspective on this. For me, in a non-executive role, this has been the number one element that I've been concerned with in Scotland to keep the morale, the confidence and the delivery of the staff at the very high level. It has been a tough time for them, and they've shown remarkable resilience in getting on with a day job. We had an enormously helpful communique from Scottish Government last night, which gave them more certainty about the future. The consultant that Ronnie referred to is an absolute first-class HR operator, and she has been instrumental in keeping everything right to the forefront for our team. I may say our head of HR from NBP has been up on a regular basis, as has our chief executive, and she committed absolutely to our team that they would know everything that came to the fore as soon as she knew it, and she has absolutely carried that out to the nth degree. So I think our team are very confident that they're getting whatever news is coming forward. As I say, this communique last night will really help them. My own personal ambition around this was that we get this fantastic resource in place retained in place for the transition to get these assets working flat out for Scotland on day two or day one. And we're closer to that, and that's a major step forward.
Thank you. Great. Claudia Beamish.
Thank you, Convener. I've raised this issue in the past, and I'd be very interested to know if, as a commissioner, or if any of the staff present today are able to comment on, as things go forward with your mission statement, the possibility of the addition of a social remit to that as we move forward. And I know it's early days, but in terms of what I've certainly seen since the short time of only 4 years on committee, but there has been perhaps a sea change in my own perception and stronger connections with communities, which I feel very positive about. And I'm just wondering if that social remit aspect has either been discussed or where you see that going.
Just start from an overall perspective. I'm sure that will be a matter for ministers for direction under the new structure, whatever that is, as Alan has already referred to, for the team engaging with communities and being able to help them, and for Ronnie and his team for engaging with these developers who are just taking absolutely colossal risks. That's absolutely, you know, part of the job, and that's where we get the fulfilment out of it, and seeing these initiatives develop. And the more they're proposed or thought about by our stakeholders, the better.
I think the key here is they're not seen as separate things. They're part of the business. And as Alan mentioned earlier on, that commercial element that we take forward just now, as Alan said, where our stakeholders and where our tenants and customers are moving forward and winning, we're moving forward and winning as well. So there's a synergy there, and we don't see them as separate.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much for that. You talk about building stronger local economies. I just was interested to know how the procurement process for producing this excellent report is handled, and if there's any possibility of it perhaps being published and printed in Scotland.
I'll be honest, I think it's part of a larger procurement program for publications. As to who publishes it, I'm afraid I don't know.
Anyway, I just thought we might note a little help that we can perhaps add to what's been said from the point of view of the staff and from the point of view of certainty and so on, because we now understand that the report stage of the Scotland Bill will take place on the 9th of November and that amendments are being lodged this week. So that will bring some certainty, at least, to the first part of that process. And I have to say, you know, it's been very useful to have you here to explain in detail what you're doing, because it's going to become a feature, I think, very permanently of future committees' activities to monitor and to encourage and to probe. And we'd like to thank you very much for all your evidence today. It certainly shows that our engagement over the last few years has led to some very fruitful and useful sessions indeed. So thank you very much, Gareth, and your team. And we will now conclude this part of the meeting by me saying that at the next meeting of the committees on the 2nd of November, the committee will be in Dumfries for our final evidence session on Stage 1 of the Land Reform Scotland Bill, and we'll be hosting a public engagement event in the afternoon before the committee formally meets in the evening to hear from the Minister for Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform. And tickets for both events are free, and those wishing to attend can contact the clerks of this committee for further details. And as agreed earlier, we will now move into private to consider our work programme, and I now close the public part of this meeting and ask the public gallery to be cleared. Thank you.